Cap L. What up, fam? Secret Society Productions. It's a Secret Society Productions. Alpha Hex. I know y'all ready. And y'all been ready. Sellout had the mindset I did. Albion hybrids, the first in fur coats. We first rode monsoons in papyrus boats. A set, the first immaculate conception. They stole the concept and Asar's erection. First Batar ray of medicine, Imhotep. If Lucy's bones were a cartoon, she's Smurfette. I say Batar ray, that's where we get farther. Paternal matriarch has been martyred. First knowledge we had has been bartered for idol gods instead of the universe charted. Our first schools didn't teach the mental bondage. Self-centered problems, no god, self can solve it. First rituals with wands, not cauldrons. The first goddess and gods are now maximum carnage. Checkmate and get rushed or dumped in garbage. Flemo and region was first in turf nonsense. Pioneers calcified and stay hard until they calcify. Axioba priests or Washita shamans. We are the future, past and present. Been here, no need to represent. We are the future, past and present. Been here, no need to represent. We are the future, past and present. Been here, no need to represent. We are the future, past and present. Been here, no need to represent. No need to represent. Been here, no need to represent. No need to represent. Been here, no need to represent. We weren't first eating Tim Hortons for breakfast. Exchanging energy for rims, Tims, and Lexus. We first spoke telepathic, no need to text us. High priest used storms with nature's trust. We first wrote scripts on walls, but not authors. Surgery and gene splicing, but not doctors. In history, that's what they called us. First get a civil mortus and then mauled us. First they called you Egyptians and now Christians. But you're first to call the system, hoeing bitches. Rapping punks first to have an orgy with two dykes. Sleeping with dogs means fleas and lice. I heard Exodus movements is filled by sea trice. First saw part one, not two of Zeke guys. Gangsters and banksters stole the first money. Credit cards by masters is money that's funny. They print the counterfeit but put a bounty on your head and call the sheriffs and the mountie. They call peace officers but call it racial tension. Seen streets are now centers of detection. UC's coming around doing inspections. They're still segregating us in sections. They're killing us all and adding to pioneer collections. Jars with goddess nipples and god's erections. We are the future, past and present. Been here, no need to represent. We are the future, past and present. Been here, no need to represent. We are the future, past and present. Been here, no need to represent. We are the future, past and present. Been here, no need to represent.
Your host, Anna Ida Ill, and I'm not sure if Roz Mariah Bay will be joining us, but if she does join us, she'll be chiming in a little bit later. All right. Tonight is Circle of Readers, and if you have been following along, we have been reading for the past couple of weeks Ancient and Modern Britons. If you do not have the book, the hard copy book, believe it or not, I was able to go up and on the moorishnews.wordpress.com website. Oh, hold on. We have Roz here after all. Islam, Roz.
Islam, how y'all doing? I am here. I'm glad to be here.
All right. All right, all right. All right, so as I was saying, if you have the hard copy, I'm trying to see where I left off. Oh, my God, I don't know where I left. Oh, yes. All right, I see where I left off. Yeah. If you have the hard copy, I believe we left off at the end of chapter 13. Oh, my goodness. If you don't have the hard copy book, to post up onto the moorishnews.wordpress.com website, below the syllabus is a picture of the book, and below the picture is a link to download the PDF of the book. Now, unfortunately, I can't tell you what the page number is in the PDF, but I can tell you that we will be starting on chapter 14, which is just as long as chapter 13 was, but it is the last of, it's actually a little bit longer than chapter 13. It's the last chapter before we get to what is called book 2 of volume 1 of Ancient and Modern Britons. So, in the hard copy book, it is page 265, chapter 14. Now, if you're new to Circle of Readers, what we do is we read for about an hour, maybe a little bit more, depending on where the chapter or where the subject matter ends. And then we have a discussion about what was read. And what we generally do is everybody who wants to participate in the discussion, you press 1 on your telephone dial, and we unmute everyone, and we have a group discussion. So, that's what we normally do with our Circle of Readers. Before I get into Circle of Readers, I just want to reiterate, tomorrow there will be another broadcast of Sons of Allah right here on this Blog Talk Radio at 9 p.m. So make sure and check back in with us tomorrow. Alrighty. Let's see. And then I think that's it. All right. So let's get started with our reading. Page 2, let me make sure it's 265. Yes, 265 of Ancient and Modern Britons. Chapter 14. The Scots of ancient Scotia, now Ireland, having spread province of our country, which has become known by their name, and the earlier Moorish of Scotland, having been seated in that territory for a longer period than their swarthy comrades of the southwest, and the later flood of Negroidenti, Dugals, or black foreigners, having invaded and ruled over a large portion of northern and western Scotland, it is clear that the inhabitants of various districts of North Britain ought to show their connection with the still existent Tory clans of our country, generally, whom we conveniently style gypsies, were, till quite recently, fixed. And to some extent, they are still Moors, like their forefathers. Therefore, we need not, and indeed cannot, distinguish between an early Scot and an early Pict, since although somewhat different in manners, they resembled each other closely enough in complexion and temperament to be equally the ancestors of certain divisions of the modern gypsy race, as they may be regarded as ancestors of certain among the civilized Melchandrio of the British Islands, but these, having long ago given up their distinctive habits, do not now differ from any other portion of the civilized population and are therefore out of court. The famous League of the Black Douglases, for example, may either be regarded as wild stocks of Galloway or as Galloway picks. So also those untamable Grammys who were expelled, the country may have belonged to either of the same two divisions, or in these and other instances where the first record of a black race cannot be traced beyond the date of the Danish invasion, that race may have sprung from black Danish or other kindred stock. The 10th century Kenneth, king of Alban, who was known as Du Niger or the Black, however, to have been a Scot, and accordingly, his swarthy complexion was quite in keeping with his supposed descent. From him, it may be assumed, those mormors of Fifi who came to bear the name of Macduff are also descended. They, at any rate, do not appear in history until shortly after the death of Dub, and as there does not seem to have been any other Dub or Black distinguished by that epithet at that time, and as the Macduff come on to the stage as men of high rank, it is reasonable to assume that the Black, whose sons they were, was the celebrated Kenneth or Niger of the 10th century. Sibbald, in his History of Fife, says that as Niger and Rufus were names of families among the Romans, from the color and complexion of men, so it seems Duff was from the swarthy and black color of those of the tribe or clan of Macduff. Thus, in this swarthy tribe, we may detect the originals of the Fifeshire Gypsy, whose ancestral habits, plundering and Moorish dancing, as well as the equally ancient practice of polygamy, are all particularized by Mr. Simpson. The Fifeshire Gypsies, of course, represent the irreconcilables of the race who only partially united their blood with that of the whites, and who were so averse to the newer faith and more sober habits that prevailed in the late times that they are not even yet properly within the pale of civilization, as already insisted upon. Such Tories have only been conservative of their ancestral habits in a limited degree. The higher qualities of the race or races have long ago become the property of the heterogeneous modern British nation, which has received some of its most powerful impulses from this origin, or those veritable Macduff, the sons of the black. We see a specimen so recently as the reign of Queen Mary in the person of Black Mr. John Spence, what was principal deviser of the murder of Darnley, and whose family point to lion rampant in their arms as proving their descent from the semi-royal MacDuff. Like the Black Douglases and other Scotch-O-Pictish tribes, those MacDuffs who desired to retain the political power of their ancestors gradually identified themselves with winning races, Normans and others, until, as in similar cases, the nominal heads of such families are, at the darkest, melanotrio, and often xanthrotrio. Their claim to Pictish blood being no stronger than that of certain Virginian families to the blood of Pocahontas, whose descendants they certainly are. Perhaps this Black Mr. Genuine Moor, or Pict, who still retained a great deal of his ancestral rank, by last century, the aristocratic descent of the purest-blooded sons of the Black still remained in the province over which their great ancestor ruled, is displayed in the attitude held by the Lochgaling band of gypsies, who looked upon such a chief as George Drummond himself as chief among his own people, as quite inferior to themselves and nothing better than a beggar tinkler. Of those MacDuffs that became gradually less and less Moorish in blood and habits, we need not speak here. It is questionable how far Shaw MacDuff, second son of a 12th century Thane of Fife, was a Moor in blood. At any rate, he comes on King Malcolm in his wars against the rebellious Moors of the district of Moravia, or Moray. This does not argue that those Moors were not his distant kinsmen, for history shows us 1,000 instances of tribes and nations of dissimilar types uniting for political reasons against an enemy composed of equally heterogeneous ingredients. But it is likely that hold on a minute. Sorry, I just lost my spot. Uniting for political reasons as enemies composed of equal. But it is likely that this Shaw or Shetch was to some extent a Moor, though like the good Sir James Douglas, a Moor that was on the side of modern civilization and the spread of Christian ideas. Whatever his own exact lineage, his wife was apparently a Norman, being a daughter of Hugh of Montgomery, one of his brother captains in the expedition against the Moorymen. To what extent the chiefs and aristocracy of northeastern Scotland were, by this time, Norman, and even impossible to decide. But at any rate, from this, Shaw MacDuff and his wife, Gill of Montgomery, descends one of the most important sections of the previously existing Confederacy of Clan Chattan. For this, McDuff and his posterity came to bear the surname of McIntosh, which it is believed signifies Mac-un, or leader, one of that large class of names laterally associated with Ireland and certain parts of Scotland, but which may have originated among Dutchmen as likely as among any other of the many races to whom the prefix Mac, Mag, or Maga belongs. Eventually, in the person of Angus, his sixth successor, the actual captainship of this line, this Angus having married in the year 1291 Eva, the only child of Dugald Dal, the last chief of the ancient clan Chattan. The lineage and probable origin of the anti-McIntosh captains of clan Chattan has been a source of much discussion, and many conflicting theories have been broached on this subject. The name of its last chief, Dugal, Dal or Blind, would lead one to believe that by the 13th century, and perhaps longer before, it had contained certain amount of the blood of the piratical Black Dane. Although the name of Dugal had probably become fossilized sometime previous to its possession by the father-in-law of Angus, McIntosh. Whatever the origin of the clan Chattan or Chattan, for the ch receives a guttural pronunciation, it is indubitably ancient, and tribes bearing the mountain cat for crest are visible a long way back and in various parts of the British Islands. We saw such a tribe included under Roulet, of whom a very old Gaelic poem given in the Dean of Lismore's book states that one battalion was cat-headed and that the same bearing was known in Wales is evident from the allusion that Hotspur makes in his petulant tirade against Glendower, and no doubt the correctness of the allusion is borne out by actual fact. The clan Chattan was therefore a very early intra-British race. Whether it ought to be regarded as originally Black Danish or early Scottish or Pictish, the last designation, in its wildest sense, is too wide to lead us to any conclusion, but in its restricted sense, it signifies the Moorish inhabitants of Scotland at the time of the Roman invasion and subsequently. Such Picts, the early Chattanooges or members of the clan Chattan, were popularly believed to be some centuries ago. The ballad of Hardy New, as it is given in Alan Ramsay's Evergreen, a collection of Scott's poems, wrote by the ingenious before 1600, contains the following line. Sin he has gained far hand a tower, Lord Chattan, land say why, that Lord a worthy which was a Cullen say his courage say try of thick rue Alden, Lord Chattan claims the pricely made Cullen he said Pictish clown. who this particular captain of the Klan cabin was, the ballot does not make sure. If this party knew was the Danish king and the line, then Reed grow his dark brown chow. See did his dark brown brow. Argue with the Lord Chatham of the ballot was a chief of the 11th century. He cannot, indeed, have belonged to a later period, for then there was no Pictish crown to say. So that whether the princely maid referred to was merely an heiress to the captain line, or higher than that, the daughter of the reigning Pictish house, it is evident that many generations before the chiefship of Blind Dougal, the line of the Cadden chiefs was only semi-Pictish, but that originally the Chatham tribe was purely Pictish is, I think, indicated by the etymology of the name, which, however, is a point for after consideration. Although the lands which King Malcolm granted to the first McIntosh were in the northeast corner of Invernessshire, and although his descendant Angus, who married the heiress of Clan Chatham, acquired by this marriage the sovereignty of the lands of Lochaber, which formed the home of his adopted tribe, yet a Hebridean in blood as a Norman, for his mother was the daughter of Angus Moor of Islay, and his maternal uncle married a daughter of MacDougall of Lorne, the head of a very powerful section of the race of black strangers. And his father had apparently been the associate of other island tribes, since it is stated that his death was the outcome of a quarrel arising during a game of draught, chess, or tables with one of the islanders. Therefore, this descendant of Kenneth Beldu of the three black divisions had inherited the blood of Hebridean or Danish Moor, as well as that of the mainland Pict. Although both these streams were apparently neutralized by currents of whiter blood. It is to the Hebridean section, however, that we ought to turn if we wish to ascertain whether, as on the mainland, in some remote districts, the unmodernized ways of the people resemble those of our modern gypsy vision. This archipelago ought to have been one of the latest territories to conform to modern ways and fashions. The inhabitants, generally, of the Hebrides, as described by Dr. Skeen, as composed of ingredients closely akin to those that made up the mixed race of Galloway men, or Galgadians. That is, they were the compound of Gauls and Gal. The wars between the Galahels and the Gaidos have been many and of long duration, and they have been closely studied by one eminent scholar in particular. And whatsoever date they began, the Hebridean archipelago appears to have been known as Inchigal, Inchigal, or the islands of the foreigners from an earlier time. These islands are regarded as the immemorial home of the Pict, and it is probably islander ensenage is also a synonym for an Indian. Otherwise, the natives of this archipelago are styled Ducalidon, and the ocean all around them, the Ducalidonian Sea. A later race of Gauls or foreigners than the Picts, however, was that of the Norman or Fingals, who were Gentiles of pure color or white men. With them, in point of time, came the opposing type of Gaul, known to the Gaels as Black Heathen, and to history as Danes. These then, with Picts, Gaels, and subsequent Normans and others, make up a great jumble of race within the Hebridean area. But we can at least ascertain something about certain sections of these islanders. And of course, in searching for gypsy-like people, our attention must be chiefly directed to those of black complexion. The traditionary inhabitants of some of these islands, it will be remembered, known as gypsies, for they are styled Kutach and Siofach, described as naked wild men living in caves and with plaited locks, and Spach or Geobag, for the transition is one of the easiest possible in Gaelic, and is rendered a gypsy by the dictionary. Let us look, then, at the gypsy-like portions of the Hebridean people, whether these are of Black Danish or of Scotto-Pictish origin. Previous chapter, the physical characteristics of some of these islanders have already been glanced at. It was seen that Martin, writing more than a century ago, stated that the people of the island of Skye were, for the most part, black. Those of Jura were generally black of complexion, and the Aran Islanders were generally brown and some of a black complexion. At least one native of the Isles of Ra Fae was black by nature as well as by name, and the clan of McRae, though not at the time of Boswell's visit inhabiting the island which had taken their name, contained among members some who were as black and wild in their appearance as any American savages whatever. Of the island men that rode the doctor and himself among the islands, Boswell, it was also noticed, remarked that they seemed so like wild Indians that a very little imagination was necessary to give one an impression of being upon an American river. One of them he particularized as a robust, black-haired fellow, half-naked and bareheaded, something between a wild Indian and an English tar. It was also noticed that half a century back, the people of Harris were thus described. In general, the natives are of small stature. Their cheekbones are rather prominent, and the nose is invariably short, the space between it and the chin being disproportionately long. the complexion is of all tints. Many individuals are as dark as mulattoes. While a later writer still, Mr. J.F. Campbell, has spoken of the short, dark native of Barra and has described a girl whom he saw among them but not of them in these terms. Her hair was as black as night, and her clear, dark eyes glittered through the peat smoke. Her complexion was dark and her features so unlike those sat about her that I asked if she were a native of the island and learned that she was a Highland girl. Her face generally reminded the observer of the Nineve sculptures and of faces seen in St. Sebastian. In all these cases, we can find every reason for understanding why the tales of the West Highlands should abound with encounters friendly and inimical with black people. In such a rough and general survey as this, taking in the descendants of so many different races, there must necessarily arise several apparent inconsistencies. At one point, the black races are seen to be of short stature, confirming the opinion of Professor Huxley. At another, as in Harris, they are taller than the whites. It has been maintained or insinuated that the reason why black is a synonymous for everything atrocious is because the black races of Scotland and elsewhere were fierce, cruel, and lustful. And that in the Hebrides, as elsewhere, certain races were absolute savages. There can be no doubt. But on the other hand, some of the writers quoted, such as the one who describes the Harris mulatto, ascribe to the dark-hued natives the possession of intellectual and moral attributes of the highest kind, attributes which rendered the Harrisian mulattoes the superiors of the Harrisian white in the opinion of their visitors. And the same testimony is afforded by the 17th century writer formerly quoted, who pictured to us the male inhabitants of Moor in the year 1688 as wearing a sporran or purse, very similar to that worn by some Hottentot races, and for the same purpose. Yet in spite of their scanty dress, he does not fail to state most emphatically that the men of this race were brave and handsome, and the women characterized by a natural beauty and a graceful modesty. But such inconsistencies must be overlooked in a hasty sketch that takes in all races and all periods. A detailed examination of the various types, if this be yet possible, would explain away such superficial contradictions to a certainty. It is enough at present to assume that all varieties of humanity were at one time low and brutal, and that a race, black or white, that in one century was essentially savage can be accurately described as refined and gentle in a later century if, in the interval, it has been subjected to such an ennobling influence as Christianity. Those Pugaches or gypsies of the Hebrides, then, were actually black savages, although like all savages, they possessed a civilization and a polity of their own. They bear different race names, and historians have told asunder and ravaged the early homes of learning and religion in Ireland, in the Isles, and throughout the larger of the main British islands. Chiefly, they are remembered as Danes or Black Heathens. One of these was previously cited in the person of a 15th century pirate known as Alan McRory, figured in an ancient Gaelic poem as the one demon of the Gael, Inchgall's great curse, the bald head, heavy worthless boar, an allusion it was proposed to his boar's helmet. The fierce ravager of church and cross, who ravaged Iona and Rilioran and several other such titles. From what period those swarthy, piratical races began to make their savage depredations, it is impossible to say. But they did not cease with bald-headed Alan and his following of devils. A century after his death, this dyad element still existed. Tannen, in his description of the Hebrides, informs us that the island of Oud has numerous caves covered with heath, the lurking places of robbers, and that opposite Loch Broom is situated the island Nindu, the island of the black, almost wholly covered with wood and of service only to the robbers who lurk there to surprise travelers, while more to the north lies Gunorth, also darkened with wood and infested with robbers. And Pennant, writing at Dunvegan last century and referring to a period antecedent to his own, tells us that each chieftain of the civilized races had his armorer bearers who preceded his master in time of war and, by my author's account, in time of peace, for they went armed even to church in the manner the North Americans do at present in the frontier settlement, and for the same reason, the dread of these savages were only the irreconcilables of their race. As on the border, we saw that although it took three generations to do it, and although many lives were sacrificed in the struggle, only savage Moss troopers became, to a great extent, peaceful, law-abiding members of the Commonwealth. So, in the Hebrides, a glance at the 17th century measures adopted by the governing powers reveals to us that the process of civilization and the preaching of Christianity for the second time was steadily going on. Therefore, since the converted Isle of the same blood as the marauding pirates, these Islemen ought to have retained something of their former manners, even after they had begun to adopt those that now prevailed throughout the greater part of Britain. Let us first glance at some of their habitations. The simplest of all these was of wholly inartificial character, and it is still in use. We talk of cave dwellers as though they are separated from us by a great stretch of time, dwellers of Europe, that is to say, but it is a simple fact that even at this day, there are many of our fellow countrymen who are cave dwellers. This has been pointed out more than once by Dr. Arthur Mitchell, and quite recently in a paper on the antiquities of the islands of Colonsay and Orinsay. Nowadays, the caves in these islands do not appear to be inhabited from year's end to year's end, but only for some months at a time. But in Martin's time, the caves of Jura apparently regularly inhabited. The summer habitations of these Jura Islanders are particularly described by Pennant, and they closely resemble the dwellings of the natives of Lachabeer. As pictured by their traveler, Lachabeer, which lies some distance to the northeast of Jura, though within easy reach of it by water, was stated to be the country of the Moorish or semi-Pictish tribe of the Catanaches or plan their dwellings at the time of his first visit to the highlands. Pennant says the houses of the peasants in Lachabeer are the most wretched that can be imagined, framed of upright poles, which are wattled. The roof is formed of boughs like a wigwam, and the whole is covered with sod. In his second tour, he describes the summer dwellings of the Jura Islanders formed a grotesque group. Some were oblong, many conic, and so low that entrance is forbidden without creeping through the little opening, which has no other door than a faggot of birch twigs placed there occasionally. They are constructed of branches of trees covered with sod, the furniture a bed of heath placed on a bed of sod, tube and a rug, some dairy vessels, and above, certain pendant shelves made of basket work to hold the cheese, the produce of the summer, the annex woodcut is copied from the illustrations in Pennant's Travels. Now, this is distinctly an encampment of gypsies or of Laps or Northern Asiatics or North Americans. It is the turf yami or coda of the Laps, and its architecture is visibly the same as that of Red Indian camp, although I am not aware that the material tarp is employed by any American tribe. As to its being gypsy, there is as little doubt. In cold country, they find shelter in caves or build huts sunk in the earth and cover them with sod laid on pole. And Leiden says of the Yathom gypsy, on Yetta's bank, the vagrant gypsies play their turf-built cot, a sunburnt swarthy race. Hold on a minute. All righty. Hold on a minute. All right. While the same description is given of the dwellings of the border Scots during the early part of the 15th century, when any Silvius afterwards, Pius II, made an adventurous visit into Scotland, he found that most of the houses on Scottish borders were not even huts, generally a small breastwork composed of mud or such materials as were at hand, and raised to a sufficient height by three or four poles meeting atop and covered with straw or turf. While those of the villages were a little better and had no door but a cow's hide suspended at the entrance. In short, these turf-built wigwams are the dwellings of the Scato Picts, or Egyptian Moors, whether we look at these people in their latest individual form, or as in the Hebrides last century, or at an earlier date than that, when they formed an important political entity in the British Islands, which their civilized and hybrid descendants still do. And their dwellings form one of the very numerous links that unite the painted Moors of Scotland with certain kindred races in Europe, Asia, and America. The turf-built cots or wigwams, which Amos Silvius shares as the common habitation of the Border Scots, Moors, or Picts during the early part of the 15th century, at that period still one of the most powerful sections of the population of Scotland, the chief of those Douglases, even threatening the supremacy of the Norman faction, himself a man of the greatest power and living in a stone-built castle, those wigwams of the Scottish borders were to be seen quite recently on Gettysbank, and others of the same description formed the summer habitations of the Jura Islanders in the year 1772. But this sod-covered wigwam can hardly be said to be the common form of gypsy dwelling at the present date. Indeed, it seems to have been given up by the Yathong gypsies since Leyden wrote. At any rate, the usual dwelling of the modern gypsy is the canvas tent, or oval or oblong shape. This structure is clearly that of the most nomadic of gypsies and liable to be taken down at any moment. And just as the sod-covered wigwam is a survival of the common habitation of historical 15th century Scots, so is this tent nothing more than a relic of the movable dwellings of the poorer Scots. Pattern gives a curious description of that mode of encampment, which he saw after the Battle of Pinkie in 1547. Here now to say somewhat of the manner of their camp. As they had no pavilions or roundhouses or any commendable compass to where their few other tents were posted, as the used manner of making is, and of these few, none of above 20-foot length, but most far under, these white ridges, as I call them, that, as we stood on Falkbed Brae, did make so great muster toward us, which I did take then to be a number of tents. When we came, we found it a linen drapery, or the coarser cambric indeed, for it was all of canvas sheet, and where the tentacles, or rather, cymbins and couches of their sole common building of their country beside, had they framed of four sticks about an L long apiece, whereof two fastened together at one end aloft, and the two ends beneath stuck to the ground, an L asunder, standing in fashion like the bows of a sow's yoke, over two such bows, one, as it were, at their head and the other at their feet. They stretched a sheet down on both sides, whereby their cabin became roofed like a ledge, but stand where the shorter, for their wives the more liberal, to lead them larger napier. Howbeit, when they had lined them and stuffed them so thick with straw, with the weather, as it was not very cold, when they were one couched, they were as warm as they had been wrapped in horses' dung. Patton's account of Somerset expedition quoted Mormon note 3F. In this description, we see plainly the ordinary tent of the modern nomadic gypsy, which style of dwelling was once, so far as the Egyptian scouts are concerned, common building of their country. It is not likely that British gypsies in recent times have made use of the hides of animals as coverings for their tents or wigwams, for the obvious reason that in a civilized country, these could not well be obtained except by purchase. Sir Thomas Dick Lauder, however, in his story of Glengarry's Revenge, seems to indicate the use of skin-covered tents when he speaks of the little group of black bodies that at such times formed his, a Highland bothy or both, the same as booth, boutique, boudica, and other forms, is radically a dwelling, more strictly a place to be in, according to Mr. Keith. And in this instance, it is of a temporary kind. In a hunting expedition such as that alluded to, the readiest made both would be one of skin stretched over a framework of branches, and probably this was kind of in use in such instances. Whom we are accustomed to regard as gypsies are not everywhere identical in dress and custom, nor is this to be wondered at, since gypsies are merely the residue of various epochs and various nationalities. With regard to the early Scoto-Egyptians or Scoto-Picts, dress, for example, seems to have been regarded as superfluity. This has already been noted. Captain Burke, in those letters which Scott has letter 22 in Ireland, ancient Scotia, a few centuries ago, the lower class seldom encumbered themselves with dress any kind within doors, and there is every reason to suppose that this was also the case among their brethren in Scotland. The extract made in a previous chapter concerning the naked rebels of Elizabeth and earlier reigns quite corroborates this. Spencer also, in describing a class of Irishmen called Carols, whose sole occupation was gambling, tells us they wander up and down, living upon cards and dice, the which, though they have little or nothing of their own, yet they will play for much money, which if they win, they waste most lightly, and if they lose, they pay as splendidly. Campion is more particular when he informs us of these carols. They play away mantles and all to the bare skin and then trust themselves in straw or in leaf. Interesting history also states the style of living among these native Irish chiefs, a dreadfully loose designation since the race of these Irishmen is not indicated by it, was characteristic of a people whose barbarism had only been endured and confirmed by conquest. The attendants of the great O'Neill, Earl of Tyrone, for the most part were beardless boys without shirts, who in the frost waved as familiarly through rivers as water spaniels. As a match to the home life of O'Neill was that of O'Kane, a great chieftain of Ulster. According to the description of the Bohemian nobleman given by friend Morrison Morrison, who on visiting him tells us he was met at the door with 16 women, all naked except their loose mantles, whereof 8 or 10 were very fair, and 2 seemed very nymph. Strange sight, his the nobleman's eyes being dazzled, they led him into the house, and there sitting down by the fire with crossed legs like tailors, and so low as could not but offend chaste eyes, desired him to sit down with them. Soon after, O'Kane, the lord of the country, came in all naked, excepting a loose mantle and shoes, which he put off as soon as he came in, and entertaining the baron after his best manner in the Latin tongue, desired him to put off his apparel, which he thought to be a burden to him, and to sit naked by the fire with this. It is surely unnecessary to add that the astounded Bohemian excused himself from complying. These and the former extracts all show that the Pictish contempt of clothing was held by certain tribes, ancient Scotia, during many centuries, and the extract just made is only one of many asserting the same thing. Dr. Jameson, in his remarks upon the word sonner or sonner, makes an additional quotation from Finnish Morrison, the one just given. Those scorners, it will be remembered, were particularly named, along with sturdy beggars, fancied fools, and others, in the acts of the Stuart king, which statutes were enacted with the express aim of putting down sorning and similar customs that were totally opposed to modern civilization, though quite lawful in the society to which they belong. Dr. Jameson, like the Scottish historian of the gypsies, clearly identifies sonners with tinklers or beggars, bay wives, fortune tellers, and horse coopers. And it will be seen from an examination of their characteristics that sonners was undoubtedly Egyptians or Scots. Mr. Simpson correctly defines scorners as forcible obtruders, and Dr. Jameson derives the word from Sorhan or Sorhen, Ireland, from their dependence. This Sorhan seems to be only another name for the custom which he describes as styled Koshrin, or perhaps the former word denotes the tribute exacted and the latter the manner of exacting it. Besides the Sorahan, the Irish lord, at least in the time of Elizabeth, subjected their tenants to occupation, which they called Koshrin. Frenis Morrison gives a strange account of their manners in a passage in which he mentions this custom. They sleep, he says, been under the canopy of heaven or in a poorhouse of clay or made of the burrows of trees and covered with turf, a hybridine wigwam in short, for such are the dwellings of the very lords among them. And in such places they made a fear in the midst of the room, and round about it they slept upon the ground without straw or other thing under them, lying all in a circle about the fire with their feet towards it, and their bodies being naked, they covered their heads and upper parts with their mantles, which they first made very wet, steeping them in water or purpose, for they find that when their bodies have once warmed, the wet mantles, the smoke of them, keeps their bodies in temperate hay heat all the night following. In this manner of lodging, not only the mere Irish lords and their followers use, but even some of the English Irish lords and their followers, when after the old but tabernacle and prohibited manner, vulgarly called posturing, they go, as it were, on progress in to live upon their tenants till they have consumed all the victuals that the poor men. This, then, is sorning, and it is plain that the custom was one that could not be endured in a properly civilized society. It was once as common in Scotland as in Ireland, as the various statutes of the Jameses show. And indeed, the descendants of the Sorners, now as low in the social scale as they were once high, have not yet forgotten that era. Tell their children of the good old time, the golden age of the gypsies, when they could wander hither and thither with little molestation and live in a measure at free quarters wherever they went. The foregoing extracts have all endorsed Captain Burt's statement that in Ireland, a few centuries ago, the lower class seldom encumbered themselves with dress of any kind within doors, and they have also made it evident that the upper classes, at any rate, in some districts, held equally broad views. Astonishing how long such notions lingered on. A visitor to the territory and islands known as the Rosses of Donegal in the northwest corner of Ireland gives us a picture of the manners of the natives at the time of his visit. The years 1753 and 1754, very much like those sketches of Fainey's Morrison. Their houses were but mere huts, consisting chiefly of one room with the fire in the middle of it. But what surprised the ordinary mode of accommodation for the night's repose? All the family lay together in one bed, and if any visitors come in the evening, they too slept with them, for they set no bounds to their hospitality. To provide lodging for the whole company, the youngest men were sent out for tarps or bent bushes, which they spread across the floor to a length sufficient for the number present, and in breadth about 6 feet. Over this little, the mistress of the house a long plaid or blanket, on which the others, having stripped off their clothes, lay down as fast as they could, men and women together, all naked. Then the mistress, having drawn the rest of the blanket over them, lay down, lasts herself naked also. This they called a thorough bed, and Mr. N was perhaps the only person who had ever before worn a shirt in it. Yet this hospitable people, so friendly and generous to those they knew, appeared at first to strangers to be wild and fierce. But after a little acquaintance and humane, especially to those they were in awe of, for in all their simplicity, there was a strong mixture of cunning. Thus, about the time of Punnett's visit to the Hebrides, a section of a race akin to some Hebrideans lived in wigwams such as those of the islanders and other gypsies in Britain or out of it, and possessed ideas of propriety quite different from those now in vogue, though identical with those possessed by their ancestors and by the lapse of today, Chala, the idea, in short, of all gypsies past and present. After his statement as to the primitive ideas of some of the people of Ireland a few centuries ago, Captain Burt adds, and there is every reason to suppose this, to suppose that this was also the case among their brethren in Scotland. The fact that their dwellings were one-roomed wigwams is of it almost a sufficient proof of the correctness of this supposition, but it is also confirmed by the writer of the above last century article in conversation with an elderly gentleman who had above 4 years ago made the tour of North Britain when I communicated what I had learned concerning the Rosses. He assured me that my description of these islanders is an exact picture of what they have seen in the Scottish Highlands and the Orkney Islands. Description given of the dwellings of certain gypsies who find shelter in caves or build huts sunk in the earth and cover them with with sods laid on poles is therefore a description of the dwellings of the Jura Islanders in past time, so that the traditional definition of putachas as naked wild men living in caves is a very correct one. Those Jura Islanders were putachas, siabachas, geabob. They lived in caves, and there is good reason to suppose that at one period they, like their brethren in Ireland, went naked, that they at one stage of their existence or in certain particular instances were wild is equally clear. Uam, which is Gaelic, means a cave, is also, according to McAlpin, a chief of savages, a terrible fellow, and of course is literally a cave dweller. And all history tells us that under historical names, or more recently as pirates and robbers, certain fierce and savage tribes harassed and the peaceable inhabitants of the Hebrides up till a very recent date, when and to what extent the non-piratical Hebrides were peaceable people may be a matter of dispute. The terms savage and barbarous are applied, writers, as those already referred to, the reference being the Collectanew de Rebus Albanistus, so lately as the year 1615, the Bishop of Argyll complained to King James that the parts of your majesty's kingdom commit to my spiritual oversight are so barbarous that without fever animad version, they cannot be cohabit from their wanted savage behavior. Therefore, while it is unsafe to generalize from particular instances, there is much reason for believing that the peaceable natives of the Hebrides attained that condition of peace by a process very similar to that by which their kinsmen on the borders became civilized. All right, so I'm going to end right there. We're on page 285 and halfway down the page, and I'm going to pick that up on, let's see, next Wednesday, I believe, which is the first Wednesday of the month. I'm just jotting it down in my book. So what we're going to do at this time is we're going to take questions about what was read. So if you have, if you would like to participate in the discussion, one on your telephone dial, and we will begin to, what I'll do is I'll unmute everyone who wants to participate in the discussion, and we will have a group discussion. So if you'd like to comment on what was read, press 1 on your telephone dial, and we will start the discussion. All righty, so I guess we don't have anybody who wants to participate in the discussion of what was read. Wait a minute now. If long, caller 808-22, is that you?
Islam.
Oh, my gosh. You made it.
Like I said, I was going to leave it in the hands of the universe, and the universe responded.
Oh, my gosh.
I had a meeting scheduled, and that last meeting that would have put me through to the end of this call was canceled at the very last minute.
Oh, wow.
The universe works.
Yes. Thank you.
And this meeting's been standing for every day.
Yes.
And today was canceled. So, yeah.
Yes. Okay. Amazing. I thought we had another participant, but they did not. They must have unmuted. So, once again, if you would like to participate in the discussion of what was read, we began chapter 14, but I remember from the last section of chapter 13, you said that there was some interesting points in the comment section at the end of chapter 13, which I didn't get a chance to read, and I don't know if anyone else got a chance to read. But
yes, there was. I just don't know. I'm working from a hotel, so I don't have my references.
All right.
Like usual.
All right.
I can see my notes.
All right. Not a problem. So we just finished reading the first, let me see what pages of chapter 14, because chapter 14 looks to be even longer than chapter 13. And we must have read, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, maybe about 10 pages into chapter 14, which was very interesting. Roz, are you on the line?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
All right. Yes, I can hear you.
All righty then. I'm glad that the brother made it.
Yes.
Islam, mother.
Islam, how are you?
Wonderful, wonderful. I hope you are as well.
Yes,
now,
I know
you're going to. Yeah, did you want to make a comment on anything for us? I got just a couple. It's always hard to make some notate some things while you're reading, you know, because then you end up stopping and pausing. But I think it was really interesting. It was really interesting when they made a reference to the appearance of these Moors over in what is called Scotland to the Moors over in America, the Indians, they call them, who are as black and wild as their appearance. Okay, yeah, because they're saying that these people over in what is called Scotland, it says they were as black and wild as in their appearance as any American savages whatever. And I was like, okay, well, we're talking about the same people. And then it talked about pigs as it is probably for this reason that the Gaelic term for an islander in Scottish is also synonymous for an Indian. You know, I couldn't do much notating, but it's clear that we're talking about the same people, regardless of, you know, the ocean between the two. So I mean, that was there's some more things, you know, there's some more things that we can talk about, but I'm gonna yield for now. Give my vocal cords a rest and take a sip of water. So I'm gonna yield the floor.
I think that quote that you was mentioning was on the bottom of page 271 from Boswell, that it was also noticed, remarked, that they seem so like wild Indians that a very little imagination was necessary to give one an impression of being upon an American river. So McRitchie has made multitudes of comments and quoted several different historians of his day making the same point that there's no difference. And you see that in chapter 14 with the descriptions of the structures that certain segments happen to live in, whether it's a wigwam, whether it's the turf-filled enclosure, a cabin, longhouse, same style of architecture, same style of build, same appearance and style, same mannerisms are shared. So what does that tell you about the people? I mean, that's something for a reader to ponder upon, as in a rhetorical sense. But I think the biggest takeaway from these two chapters and segments of red is that regardless of what a person may think of today, at some point, it is really clear from McRitchie's account that there was larger population of Moors from, based on what we read, not just in this chapter, but in the earlier chapters, from the time of the Roman Empire. You know, when Rome invaded Britannia in 49 BC, he was real clear to say that the Romans had two divisions, one Moorish, one modern-day European. And that the modern-day European, in his description in the earlier chapter, their job was to lay in the back, wait until the destruction, until the fight had occurred, and pick up remnants of things that would be useful as they continued on, because at that time there was no Walmart, Kmart stores for you to pick up and resupply. And as you know, a military or armed force basically lives on its stomach. If you can't get supplies or if there's no resources in the area, then they perish. which happens if you read into the Moorish history in Europe by S.P. Scott, you'll get more detail into what had happened in these great battles, supposed great battles from Christian historian, for Christendom historians in the Apennines or the Alpines or the Pyrenees mountain ranges. They clearly states, you know, they go in thinking they can take on Mother Nature, but it may be 12, a dozen, a small band of Moors sprinkled throughout the range at higher elevations that are able to just take them out, because you're funneling through into a small passage, maybe between two mountain ranges through that valley. So you got the higher elevation, you have the winning advantage. As well.
You're saying the elevation.
No, you're good.
No, did you mention, I wasn't sure about the Alps. Is that what you're making a distinction of and how they're connected?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, the Alps,
yes.
And the Pyrenees. The Pyrenees,
exactly.
Are the mountain ranges that are on the back end of the Alps that separate through Spain, what today is Spain, Portugal, in the Iberian Peninsula. So there are countless battles that are documented by Christian historians that inflate what really had happened. And specifically, S.P. Scott in the history of the Moorish Empire in Europe in those three volumes, he gives detailed comparisons of the same events between a Christian historian and a Muslim historian. And it always turns out that the Muslim historian is more accurate because they didn't embellish. They just listed it as it was because they didn't see it as a major battle. It was just, you know, it happened. This is what happened.
So interesting. Yeah, and so interesting. And that is also why they say, when they'll say they had a battle in the Alps, or they'll talk about the Alps, people think of the Swiss Alps, not realizing they could be talking about the Appalachian, which is right here, because they're all really one and connected. Interesting, right?
Exactly. Exactly. For me, I think the bigger, one of the takeaway points that I came away with from my initial reading of this book was getting clarity as to the, when did the modern day appear? You know, so this is one text, even though he doesn't go into specifics as far as more than just the year, specifically 49 BC, to say that that's when the Romans invaded Britannia. But he gives a detailed account. McRitchie gives a detailed account of what the armed force looked like, and specifically stated that there was two distinct divisions, one all Moorish and one all modern day, that worked hand in hand. But basically that the modern day's task was, they were the cleanup crew. The Moors rolled through, took out the forces, and whoever was, you know, mortally wounded but not necessarily dispensed of, they basically took them out and picked up whatever supplies they could that would be beneficial to both divisions. Whereas we just went through, we were truly the advanced force to just fight, because, you know, hand-to-hand, there was no competition. And that's throughout in just about every single account that I've come across in a multitude of resources. Same story, just keeps getting repeated. Locations change, the actors change, or the characters, the historical characters change, but the results and the tactics stay about the same.
Wow, how interesting. The vastness of the study and the connections. Wow.
Yeah, the same with McRitchie goes over the original Danes, and he he makes, I don't know, I lost count now of how many references to the original Danes being Moors, but he does also give us a little hint in regards to 1453 being a pivotal year, and even prior to then, about 450 years or 450 some odd years prior to the king or queen Elfric, and how they passed a order post paying the tribute to the Moorish nation 2 days after the warring Moors had the warring Danish Moors had left. I probably shouldn't say Danish because they're not Danish. They were Dane. They were the Danes.
The Danes.
When they
right.
left with the Danes. When they left with the 24,000 pounds of gold, 2 days after they were gone, Alfred ordered all Dane males to be killed on sight. And that's recorded in history as St. Bryce Day Massacre from the year 1002 or 1004.
Wow,
I'm working off memory. I don't have my resources.
Someone just told me about the St. Bryce Day, and we need to look into that. Wow, what a
yes.
tie-in here.
Yes, but that's the story that leads to it. Basically, the king was a weakling king, and I came across another resource that says that Alfric, which is the name of the supposed king, wasn't really a king. It was actually mm-hmm. a mother. She was actually a queen, but she went through. But in those times, similar in ancient, I don't want to say ancient, but in Kemetic times during the dynastic pharaohs, there were pharaohs who were mothers, but when it mm-hmm. came time to address them, they wanted to be addressed as male, as opposed to, or looked upon as male, to do the same within battle or within negotiation.
For the battle portion.
And female.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. We have to watch those transitions as well, you know. You know, when we go into some of the words that I'm trying to think of something, not, well, king, queen, and different things like that. But that sounds like they're like, no, we are, this is the family, this is the matriarch, this is the land, this is the people. You know, it's not really about, like, if you're going to are the head of this, so whatever, you know, we're going to be.
Right.
Right.
And
right.
then if you have an outsider who's documenting it as from the historical perspective, even if it's of that day, they may, because of the, for lack of a better term, political climate at the time, refer to in the manner that the monarch wished to be referred to. So if she says, you call me king, I'm calling you king all day long because I don't want you to kill me. I mean, it's pretty... It makes the backtracking through historical annals a little more interesting because if you come across that, it sheds more light into the situation. But regardless of whether it was a king or a queen or empress or emperor, it's still what really matters is what transpired. So with the St. Bryce Day Massacre, the big difference there is besides the continuance or confirmation of the payment of tribute, in this case, in that specific case, 24,000 pounds of gold. The more important piece is that whoever that king was or queen or whoever that monarch was ordering the kill on sight order, they weren't killing hostile Danes. They were killing Danes who had come previously that may have been generations past and been spouses to who amalgamated with other families and had nothing to do with the actual violence. They just lived there because at some point in time, someone from their bloodline decided to shut up shop. And live there,
you know,
as opposed to going back. Yes.
No. Let's talk about this, because that was what I was going to say. When you mentioned, well, the ancient Moors and the modern Moors, and I'm glad you brought it to this point, because we must really get to understanding, and you just said it, is that they were related. In other words, if you're standing there and your mother is a Moabite, and let's say, you know, you're amalgamated, and your uncle on your on one other side of the family is totally straight up European. Now you have this mixture. You've got a Moabite on this side, and you've got the modern European Slavic as your family on another side, or vice versa. You know, your mother may be a Slavic, but your uncle on a you know is a straight up dark melanated Moor. This is where the division.
Right.
This is where the division is, and where they say, "Well, I'm a Moor," or you know, it's like this person is saying, "Well, my uncle's a Moor and my aunt's a Slavic." This is what we have really got to understand. Also, why what you are comes through the bloodline of your mother. It is so important that we accept that, because that's a part of that clears up all of it. But that's
exactly
where the fight really came.
Yeah, because if the person is recanting their genealogical line, but they're coming from the from the patriarchal side, what are they really telling us then? Not much, because they're under the misunderstanding that they think the bloodline's coming from father, when we know bloodline comes from mother. You are what your mother was, and you are what your mother's mother's was. So if you can't go back several lines, I mean, if you have that mixture with his, you know, in the scenario you pose, where you have half at the first junction of amalgamation, it really is driven by, was the mother a Moor or the father? But then at that point, if once you get a few generations down from that, then it's that looking at the definition of free white person. You know, you can't be a free white person unless you're a mixed Moor.
You said you can't be a free white person unless what?
Unless you actually have mixed Moor in you.
Right.
If you look at the definition.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Now, Islam, I just want to make mention, Cynthia, is that you, 267-229?
Yes.
Oh, there you are.
Yes.
I've been waiting to, you know, just,
Islam,
I didn't want to get interrupted.
I couldn't tell if I was in. I couldn't tell if I was in because it said I was unmuted. It said unmuted, and I was like, what?
Yep, you're in. I was just waiting for a good time to interject and let you know that you're unmuted and you've joined the conversation. Islam, and welcome.
Yes, Islam. Yes, it was the brother Dunn, Ross Mariah, because I wanted to jump in on that about the amalgamation piece.
Do so, my sister.
Please, go right ahead.
Okay, in this chapter, he talks about mulattoes. And so I wanted to share some things just for the sake of discussion or a comment or two. But I actually looked up the word in Black's Law Dictionary, and it was there for tradition. And it's described, the mulatto is a person that is the offspring of a negress by a white man or of a white woman by a Negro. Now, I'm quoting what's directly out of the Black Thought Dictionary. In a more general sense, it is a person of mixed Caucasian and Negro blood, or Indian and Negro blood. Then it goes on to say that properly, a mulatto is a person, one of whose parents is wholly black and the other wholly white, but the word does not always, though perhaps it does generally, require so exactly even a mixture of blood, nor is its signification alike in all the states, okay? I think the wording in this is all very interesting. Also, according to Black's Law Dictionary, the word Negro means a black man, one descended from the African race, and does not commonly include a mulatto. But again, the laws of the different states are not uniform in this respect, some including the description Negro, one who has one-eighth or more of African blood. And it concludes with, the term Negro means necessarily person of color, but not every person of color is Negro. Now, literally mulatto means young mule, and it comes from the Latin mulus, M-U-L-U-S. I'm out of Black's Dictionary right now, which reportedly results from the mating of a donkey and a horse, and the mules are said to be sterile. Now, additionally, I came across an old article featuring comments by Halle Berry, in Ebony Magazine. And she was asked if her daughter, Nala, is African American. And Berry replied, I feel like she's Black. I'm Black and I'm her mother and I believe in the one drop theory. Now, interestingly, Berry didn't use the words mixed or biracial to describe her ethnophenotype. She identifies as a Black woman. It was also reported that similarly, President Obama, Faith Evans, Jasmine Guy, and the late Bob Marley all embraced having a white parent, but didn't identify by the degree of Blackness. Then you have Tiger Woods, who has been noted as one to actively divorce himself from the Black descriptive. He reportedly even rejected being labeled the first Black golfer to win the Masters. And this goes back to what was stated in Black's Law Dictionary. Not all melanated people are Negro, Black, or African American, especially if you are speaking in terms of nationality. Now, I just added that at the end. Needful to say, some may find the reference to mulatto offensive. Interestingly, about 2 years ago, someone wrote to Professor Henry Louis Gates informing him that they recently discovered that they have an ancestor identified as mulatto on the 1850 and 1860 census records. Now, I think McRitchie takes us all the way back to the origin of this, the use of this word, which is around the 1500s. Her name in this situation is Amelia Moreland, okay? Born in 1818 in Virginia. She is listed as living with William White Mullen and three children, also with Moreland surnames. All children were also listed as mulatto. By the 1900 census, one of the children changed their surname to Mullen. He was still listed as Moreland on the 1880 census, and that Moreland is spelled M-O-O-R-E-L-A-N-D. And he was listed as white. This was in Hardy County, Virginia. Now, I think it's called West Virginia. It's important to note, this is important, that the status of a person listed in the federal census was ultimately the personal interpretation of the census taker based on assumptions made regarding skin color and other aspects of an individual's appearance, regardless of how the occupant of the home self-presented to the census taker. Hence, we can't necessarily infer much of anything about a person based on a designation in a census record. However, in this case, I think it's clear that a local person was making a declaration of mixed-race ancestry in their family tree or their relative's family tree. But I want to point out, too, before I yield the floor, notice how McRitchie suggests even a caste system within the mulatto designation on page 273, where he describes the Harris or Harisian mulattoes as the dark-hued natives who possessed intellectual and moral attributes of the highest kind, which positioned them as superiors. And with that, I yield the floor.
Excellent.
I had a little trouble with some of the wording here because it's like you said, Raj, the, you know, your nationality is your bloodline, and that's determined by your mother.
Absolutely. And you can see here
determined
why.
Determined by mother, yes. So I have, you know, I have problems with the mulattoes that, you know, with, I think Tiger Woods kind of has the right idea, but I don't know if he understands it like that. I'm not sure.
I tell you, I was watching something. Who was it? My boy, Morgan Freeman, and he was making a clear statement that everyone keeps saying that Barack Obama, first of all, was the first black president. And he said, and I'm going to find that clip and send it to you. He said, no, his mother was a European. He is not the first black president, right? And you know,
right.
I just don't want to, really want to hear that.
Right. But when I referenced Tiger Woods, I think a lot of people were coming down on him because they were saying, oh, he's a black person who doesn't want to be black.
Right.
But,
I got you. Yeah.
Yeah, but, you know, I don't know whether he understands the bloodline part of this or not, but I think he's on the right track, and I didn't take offense to it, you know, after I understood what bloodline is, you know, and how you establish nationality.
Right.
Islam, but in regards to Tiger Woods, regardless of what he thinks, isn't he still just an Asiatic?
Yes.
I mean, his mother's Asian.
I think both of his parents are Asiatic.
Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't his mother Korean?
Korean or Japanese? Nepalese or Korean? One of the two. And so, with his father. So if he may or may not understand the term black, or maybe he does and he's playing aloof. But if you bring up a great point in regards to the term mulatto, I kind of got from this last reading kind of a question in my head. If, and I'm not saying that, I'm not trying to belittle the horrific past, whether true or embellished, but the stories are there. But I'm wondering if the whole caste naming of Octoroon, mulatto, and all that nonsense wasn't the modern day trying to keep track of who's really who's real and who's not, who's true possessor or true inheritor of the estate and who is not. I don't know if that question makes sense or not to the group.
Oh yeah, it does. It does, and that's a good point. That's a very good point.
A couple of other items. Sorry, I'm by the airport and you have to mute from time to time.
That's all right. That's all right. You're good. Let's see. Hey, did you have, okay, so I was good. Well, you know what? That latter section of chapter, or the end of chapter 13, it's got like a whole lot of footnotes. Like, it's like, it looks like, you know, if you were to put it together, it would be a whole page of footnotes, which we didn't read, you know, at our last reading. So maybe it's something that we can revisit when we come back to this. I made some other notes, unless there was something you recall off the top of your head.
Of the notes from chapter 13, I had I highlighted like the second paragraph of note one. Therefore, if North Britannia contained nothing but Picts and Scots at the time of the Roman invasion, it is pretty certain that it contained no white men at that date. And the first fair whites that entered Scotland must have been the Batavian soldiers of the Roman army, or the Celts of southern Britain, or Norsemen, or Gentiles of pure color. If, on the other hand, Mr. Grant Allen's supposition that a body of Celtic or early Belgian invaders had crossed into Britain before the dawn of history, and though numerically few, had established themselves in that island as a ruling military caste, it is the supposition, if this supposition be held to extend to North Britain also, then it is probable that while the majority of the North British were certainly painted Maori, yet the aristocracy, and it finishes on the next page, it actually drops. That quote actually drops. You didn't end it in the book, or at least in the copy that I have. But that first portion of chapter of the second paragraph of that note that ended chapter 13 kind of gives you his speculative findings of his time to try to explain where the modern day European may have came into play in the history of Britannia. So again, it goes back to either the Romans, the Roman empires, which he clearly states, we know that was Moorish as well, for the majority part of personnel, for persons that were there at that time frame. So if they know and they're stating it, I'm just trying to get to see at what point they come to being. Because I know of the Yaqub's experiment, the 5,000 years or so, but I'm trying to find historical facts to support or, you know, to prove or disprove that folklore of history that we have. Hope that makes sense.
Which note was that? Is that on page
262? Yes, 262. It's the bottom of, it says note one. It's the second paragraph. Note two, he goes over into Black Murray and Swarthy and Grimm.
Okay, I'm trying to find it. I see note one, paragraph two starts with, therefore, if North Britain contained nothing but Picts and Scots, are you talking there?
Yes.
Are you speaking from me?
No,
okay.
Note two is on halfway down page 263.
Note one, second paragraph is what I just read. And
note
on
one,
page 263, right, on page 263, in the top paragraph of the page, about six sentences in, he says, indeed, the word that has been Latinized in the cattle dones may itself be nothing else than galheldone or brown gales.
Brown gales, yes.
And brown gales, and we know gales, those were who became what we call today German.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, Gaul was really a combination of South France, of today's South France and Germany. So the imaginary borderlines have moved much.
Okay.
But he goes into Richie does go into nationalism too, because right after that, he's like, thus the North British of anti-Roman, anti-remember is Latin for before, not it doesn't mean against, it means just before, so antebellum, before the big war, anti-Roman, before the Romans' times, the almost entirely painted Moors may still have been Gauls by nationality, and to some extent in speech, though the superimposed white or pure Gaelic element may have almost disappeared out of sight, swallowed up ethnologically by the Swarthy Moorish population. Mm-hmm. So they even knew back then, you drop a fair one there and hook up with whoever, you know, down the line, you come back, you know, in 18 months or 20 months, you might see different offspring. I think that's what he was covering. You know, I'm making light of it, but he did. McRitchie was not. A couple of other points I wanted to cover were the areas that he discussed. I'm not sure if anyone on the line or anyone who's listening has had the opportunity to travel in, say, north of what we call today Philadelphia, but the northern part of Pennsylvania by the mountain ranges of the Poconos, Lenape territory, you'll see towns that are named in McRitchie's books. So we have, I currently have domicile by a town called Scotia, S-C-O-T-I-A, which is next to another quote-unquote town named Jutland, J-U-T-L-A-N-D. And you have streets within both in multiple towns that are named like Fa or Fawns or Falls. In fact, there's a Falls, Pennsylvania, with the main tree being sycamore. But it always spoke to me. I just didn't know what it was saying until I came across and started reading McRitchie's book as to why those towns were, or those areas were resonating with me, to say the least.
Wow, that's, you know, I've noticed that. And, you know, if you go into, let's say, and I know it's kind of just for ha-ha, they have online these various different programs where you could put in like your birth date and time of date, and you can get your astrology information. So one of the things that I noticed in them, in it, is if you put in a city, all right, if you just put in the city alone, nothing else, you will find that this city, it's like they have the name in almost every, what they call Union State. They also have this name, you know, outside of the North American continent as well. And so, you know, what you're saying, you know, in terms of these names that we just read in this book also being, you know, places on this North American
current
continent.
Current places today.
Yes, you absolutely, it's absolutely correct. And so, and just, you know, from my perspective, it just demonstrates, and I think I might have mentioned this on a previous broadcast, but it just affirms that. It affirms that these are nothing more, you know, modernly, they're nothing more than companies. Just like you have a McDonald's over here, you have a McDonald's over in, say, Russia, or, you know, just from that perspective. You know, they're letting you know that they're all companies. They're really nothing more than companies. And, you know, and sometimes this information, the information that we are reading in this book, also is demonstrating that to a degree. Because in the first sentence of chapter 14, it talks about the Scots of ancient Scotia.
Yes, now Ireland.
Which is now called Ireland. And it's interesting because we were talking with a guy yesterday, and towards the latter part, he was the last caller on last night's broadcast, and we were saying, look, the word Ireland is it's denoting a company, and the people who agree to be members are called Irish, but the ancient people of that land were never called Irish. And then today, the first chapter in the book says the Scots of ancient Scotia, now called Ireland.
Ireland. That's how the universe works.
But also, I just wanted to make one more because I'm, you know, it's so hard to notate, and you know, as so many things going on, I couldn't put my hand on my highlighter, so I took a red pen and I was just circling stuff. But on the bottom of page 267, I thought it was most interesting where it talks about, now this is distinctly an encampment of gypsies, which we know gypsies to be Egyptian, or of Laps, or Northern Asiatic, or
yes.
North American. I was like, okay, and we still talking about wars. So
the Egyptian,
which then became gypsies, which then became Lance, which also are the Picts, all right, which are also Northern Asiatic or North Americans or also Moors. We are all of these names are talking about the same people. Like,
mm-hmm.
It's the same people. And,
yeah.
You
well,
know. And,
that's the same thing that, along that same point. Oh, I'm sorry, Mother. I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
I was going to say, along that same point, we have Caledonians, and on the bottom of page 270, they have Due Caledonians and the Due Caledonian Sea. Now, that Caledonia always jumped up at me because I had seen mention of it in other annals that I've come across. And apparently, the Caledonians, I wish I had the source with me so I can give the reference of author and page number, but I'm working from memory. From what I've read before this call, Caledonians were actually the quote-unquote ancient Phoenicians after that society fell. Some migrated, moved just outside of and became established the nation that was known as Caledonia. And that I also found that there really was not a Phoenician or Phoenicia per se. The people didn't call themselves that. That was a tag that was put on by others that came across to do commerce. So I say all that to say that some words that we come across in more modern annals, a more modern history text, are actually another tongue's translation of some visitor, some forwarder's misrepresentation, whether purposely or innocently, I don't know. Don't know what, can't speak for what was in their heart or in the mind at the time of doing so. This is way before my existence, but it still traces back with you if you're astute enough to study. That you'll see the traces that link you back to that and makes you go, oh, that makes more sense. Because whether you're talking about Caledonians, whether you're talking about Moores, or you're talking about the Mori, where you talk about Murray, you're still just saying Moor. It's just
That's
they
true.
Have multiple words because those multiple words could have come from multiple people who didn't speak the tongue or didn't really understand what they were saying. So they came with their pronunciation of. Even today, we do that right here, right now, in modern day. You ever have a chocolate? That's not what it's called. That's what we refer it to. That's actually the French pronunciation. Chocolate. It was just that we don't say with that accent, we say chocolate, but it's actually chocolate. It's an indigenous word. It's ours. That's why if you read anything dealing with the Shi people, this number that's Olmec or old mixture, or what they say now more modernly Aztec Mayan, those terms, you'll see them making what they call today Mexican hot chocolate with pepper as well as the cacao. You know, and there's other terms in Spanish for things that we use every day, like avocado. You know, the avocado is not what it was called. We never used the term avocado. We call it what it was, aguacate, which is what is now used in modern day Spanish for the same plant, the same fruit. So, getting into etymology, you have to look more than just into the English etymology. Once you also have other tongues' etymological dictionaries as well.
Yeah. Islam. Well, we got maybe 1/4 through chapter 14, and we got a good ways to go. So we go. How about we wrap it up for tonight? And let's see, next week. Let me look in my calendar because I don't think we have 5 weeks in this month. No, we don't. So next week is the first Wednesday of the month, and so we're going to pick back up, on the 3rd, next week, with the next section of chapter 14 and continue reading The Ancient and Modern Britons by David McRitchie. I want to thank everybody for participating. Oh my goodness, you guys have no idea how priceless your feedback is. We had another caller, and let me see if I can see if he can make his comment, because caller 510-3 there.
I am. Assalamu alaikum. I was just wanted to say greetings. And I tuned in very late. I was traveling on the road.
Uh-huh. Everybody's
but
traveling.
I just wanted to I just wanted to greet everyone, and I look forward to the listening to the rebroadcast of the class. I'm Anthony Shankle Bay, calling from Khalifa Territory, Morocco, actually.
Yes.
Islam.
And
I'm in your territory, brother. I'm in your territory right now.
Oh, okay. All right.
I'm in area known as San Jose, actually. But I found some interesting facts about that too. I kind of found it funny that the quote-unquote city of San Jose was established in 1777. So I'm like, really? 1 year after?
What?
Really? Okay.
What?
1 year.
Yeah. And I love what you shared about avocado and chocolate.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It's all in language. You know, there's so much history in language, and we miss a big piece of it when we don't explore that. You know, there's like, I mean, it's another show. it's another show that we'll have to have when we talk about the different languages, because there's such a lot to talk about, and there is in fact history in the languages. So with that, what we're gonna do?
Let me say this: Duolingo. I was talking to someone that relocated to Costa Rica. She retired and went to Costa Rica, and she was talking to somebody that was speaking pretty good Spanish. And he said he just simply started using Duolingo. That's a language program that's for free, of course, but that you can use. And it's 5 minutes a day. You can, and they have all the different languages, but Spanish is one of them. Different languages you can use to learn to speak the different languages. I just want to put that out there on the table.
Well, I'll tell you, because I'm not trying to promote nobody, but but I can tell you, not trying to promote any of these people, but I'll tell you that one of the most effective language courses that I have ever taken was, believe it or not, I'm not sure if he's a modern European, but the name of the guy is Michael Thomas. And I don't know if you've ever heard of him, but he doesn't do books. He doesn't do memorizing, you know, and the way he puts the language together, like he introduces you to words that, you know, you were already using, but you didn't know was not really English. And I've used him for Spanish, and I've, like, gotten so far ahead with that. And I'm currently using him for Arabic and Manchurian.
Wow.
So, but I'll say this. When you do just a little bit of studying of a language, a true language, because English is not a true language. When you do just a little bit of studying of a true language, you will see that once you learn a little bit of one, you kind of have the formula for any other language. Because every language so far that I've come across follow the same pattern, except English.
Yep.
So far, you know, I've looked at a lot. So far, English is the only language that doesn't follow the pattern of every other language out there, and it doesn't. And it doesn't
Islam.
Have a history. Islam.
If I can make one comment on that, one thing that helped me out as I started on my personal inter journey was developing a timeline of what languages, when languages appeared and began being used, documented, structured. And by setting up that timeline, it told me a lot more about when I came across words and its origin would be credited to a newer language. Because if you don't have that timeline, and you see that in Portuguese today, water is aqua. But then you notice, then you find that in modern day Spanish is agua. And then you go further back and then see that in Sanskrit, it was ahua. You start seeing the sound and the progression of how the people migrating or traveling further into different regions, how certain syllables, its pronunciation, have changed. Mm-hmm. And then when you see when the language was, quote-unquote, officially recognized at whatever stage, it gives you more of an interpretation of where this is coming from. So I use, like, the simplest words that you know that would be common if you were to travel the earth. You know, if you were on ocean for days or weeks or months, you get to land, you might be looking for water, fresh water, first thing. So I would want to know how that is said and what it's heard as there in that region. So you can track the progression. Yeah.
Yeah.
Islam.
Islam. Islam. My Moabitis is from Kenya. And there's been times when we're fellowshipping together, just whatever we were together, and they would tell jokes, and they would say, "We don't have the word in English for what was just laughed or just joked about." So it's real when you said that English is not a real language of the world. I want to put it out there, at least in Swahili. So just something else that I've had personal experience in only speaking English. So it benefits us to really learn the different languages and it expands our understanding, just like you demonstrated. Just put
yes,
that out
it
there.
Does. Yes, it does. It does. So thank you. I want to thank everybody for participating in tonight's Circle of Readers. Oh, my goodness. Couldn't have done it without you. For real, for real, for real. For our next installment of our Circle of Readers, where we will pick back up with Ancient and Modern Britons, Volume 1, moving into Book 2 of Volume 1. I can't wait to see what that says. I just can't wait to finish this book, because I'm telling you, it's chock full of information, but it's just so much of a brain twister. I need another type of reading to give my brain a break. So
you did a wonderful job on that old English, because there was misspelled words left and right that I didn't get when I read it three times.
Yes, you did. It's not an easy read, that's for sure.
I'm looking for much kudos for everyone, because I'm reading this for you guys. It's like you don't have
doing
to read
fine.
It yourself.
You're doing fine.
All right, so we'll see you next week, and thank you again for this wonderful Circle of Readers. Peace and love, everyone.
Peace and love.
Kudos. Great job.
Wake up, everybody. No more sleeping in bed. No more back to thinking. Time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war, and poverty. Oh, wake up, all the teachers. Time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. They're the ones who's coming up, and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children, teach them the very best you can. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. Na 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 na. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it, girl. Just you and me. Wake up, all the doctors, make the old people well. They're the ones who suffer and who catch all the hair. But they don't have so very long before their judgment day. So won't you make them happy before they pass away? Wake up, all the builders, time to build a new land. I know we could do it if we all lend a hand. The only thing we have to do is put it in our minds. Surely things will work out. They do it every time. The world won't get no better if we just